All right, everybody, welcome back. I'm Rich Fahle. We are at the Miami Book Fair 2018. You're watching PBS Books coverage of this incredible event, and I'm sitting right now with David Grann, who's joined us here before.
Yes.
Most recently for Killers of the Flower Moon, a finalist for the National Book Award, still in the rear, not too far in the rearview mirror. Yeah, we're here today to talk about White Darkness, your newest book. First of all, congratulations on everything that's happened with Killers of the Flower Moon, and how exciting to see this new book here.
Thank you.
The new book, though, wow. First of all, beautiful.
Yes.
It's a different kind of book for you. There's a lot of visual media inside, a lot of photos. It's like a gift book of sorts. It's really pretty.
Yeah, they integrated with more than 50 photographs from Shackleton and Henry Worsley's polar explorations for the Antarctica. And as you'll see with some of these photographs, they tell a story unto themselves. And Antarctica is such an alien realm. It was more like writing about Mars than any place on Earth. And so having this kind of multimedia, having these photographs really echo the story in a beautiful way.
Yeah, I mean, we should tell people what it's about too. It's a White Darkness is a story of people who have a relation to some of the folks within Ernest Shackleton's original crews. There was a number of different expeditions that Ernest Shackleton went on, always in cold weather expeditions. And Shackleton, famous for the Endurance on his way to the South Pole and the Antarctica, and before that, the Nimrod. Yep. And you found these people who are as that there were direct relations to Shackleton who followed in his path and wanted to go down and make their way to the South Pole as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. So, I mean, Shackleton is one of our most revered polar explorers from the early 20th century. He set out to try to reach the South Pole a couple of times. He then tried to famously trek across Antarctica, but his ship, the Endurance, got frozen in ice and sank. Shackleton failed in all his missions. He never reached the South Pole first. He never trekked across Antarctica. But he, through almost uncanny leadership and powers of endurance, managed to managed to get his parties back to safety. And so the person at the center of this book is a man named Henry Worsley. He is a polymath, a revered British Army officer who kind of modeled his life after Shackleton. He had a special connection to Shackleton, as you mentioned, because one of his ancestors had been part of the Endurance expedition. He always wanted to become a polar explorer. And then finally in 2008, he set out with two other descendants of Shackleton's original crew, including a great grandnephew of Shackleton. And they set out to try to succeed where Shackleton had failed in the most brutal environment on Earth.
Yeah, they call it unfinished business.
Yes. One of them calls it unfinished.
But it seems like it haunted them. Like it passed through the generations to people who's like, we need to finish what you didn't finish.
Yes, and what's amazing is on that expedition, they even carry Shackleton's compass on their way to the South Pole, hoping that this time that compass will reach the South Pole.
We'll actually be able to go do South.
We'll actually be able to do it. And, you know, what's amazing about these people is, I mean, just to give some sense of them is, you know, they had exploration in their genes, but they had no actual experience as explorers before they did this. I mean, Henry Worsley was a remarkable commander and army officer. He served as an officer with the SAS, which is an elite commando unit. But again, he had not been an explorer. And so they begin this ruthless exercise regimen. They're dragging tires
across
fields.
There's a picture of them dragging tires.
Yeah, because when they would do these expeditions, they would have to bring all of the provisions with them. And so you have to haul your sled with all your food. Of course, you can only carry so much, which leaves you...
And kerosene and other heavy things.
Leaves you vulnerable to starvation. So their sleds, their pulks weighed about 310 pounds when they started out, including the weight of the sled. And just to give you some examples, image of the conditions they were heading into. I mean, Antarctica, again, it's more like Mars. It is the windiest continent with winds reaching up to 100, even 200 miles an hour, they've been recorded. It is, of course, the coldest continent with temperatures reaching minus 100 degrees Fahrenheit. It is the highest continent in terms of elevation. And to me, the strangest thing about the continent is 98% of it is covered in an ice sheet. And yet it is also the driest continent because there's so little precipitation. I mean,
the pictures are absolutely haunting as they go through there. And the idea, the words, the white darkness, speak to what happens when they're basically stuck in these tents or they're out traversing these difficult, terrain. And the white is coming down so much that it's as if there's no light. It is white darkness.
It literally is white darkness, and of course a metaphor as well. And what's so interesting is because there's not a lot of precipitation, it's not like there's a lot of snow, but these 100-mile-an-hour winds, these hurricane-force winds, they kick up the ice particles. They become surrounded in these whiteouts and inside the white darkness. When you're inside that, you cannot tell which way is up or down. They would often take a step the wrong way, thinking that was down, and they would fall over. It would be so destabilizing that one of them got motion sick and threw up because he was as if he was on a ship. He described it as being trapped inside a ping pong ball on a boisterous ocean.
Yeah, so how did you find Henry Worsley? I mean, how did he cross your path? So you find these interesting stories, and I don't know how you choose each one because you're going to spend time with them for a while, but how did he cross your path?
Well, I hate the cold, but I've always been fascinated with polar explorers ever since I was young, reading about Shackleton, reading about Amundsen, reading about Scott, these people who would go to this incredibly forbidding place in pursuit of some Arctic rail. And so in 2015, when I read a story that Henry Worsley was going to plan to set out to do what his hero, Shackleton, had failed to do a century earlier, and that was on this expedition to walk across Antarctica, trek from one side to the other, what Shackleton had hoped to do in the Endurance expedition, I was immediately drawn to the story. What made Worsley's expedition even more extraordinary was Shackleton had planned to be part of a large expedition. Worsley, who was then 55, planned to do it alone, unsupported, and unaided, meaning there'd be no food caches planted along the way to forestall starvation, and they'd have to haul that, he'd have to haul all his food, all his supplies on a sled without the help of kites or dogs. Nobody had ever dared to do it before.
Yeah, well, when he found these two other people to do it with him, but later in the book, you write about how he went back out, and he literally crossed the pole, and there were people there, and he would not go inside, get warm, have a meal, say hello. He slept in his tent, basically outside.
Yeah, so that solo trek was is about 1,100 miles. It traverses through the South Pole. Worsley had encountered, just the way Shackleton had on his expedition, everything went wrong. Constant whiteouts, freezing temperatures. He had lost, 40 pounds. He gets to the South Pole, which is the first phase of the journey. It's a bit more than half. And there's a U.S. scientific research base. But because he is doing this solo and unaided, he can't go into the base. I could not think of a greater temptation.
Give him a cup of coffee.
He can't go in and get a cup of coffee. He cannot go warm up. And he has to kind of set up his tent down a little bit ways in his self-imposed exile. And I just found that so poignant that here he was. But he saw it as this great singular test of character, a test of leadership under those conditions. I mean, the interesting thing about polar expeditions, and getting back to your question about what interested me, is that they are in many ways the perfect test for human dynamics. History is studded with expeditions in Antarctica under those conditions of members turning on each other, backstabbing, bickering, mutinying. There's even been cases of murder. Worsley was a remarkable leader, and he saw these expeditions as tests of his leadership skills. Of course, in this last expedition, he is the leader only of himself, and in some ways, that is the most challenging.
Yeah, what I like is that this book talks about Worsley and Gow and Henry Adams, the three people who took off together, and then Worsley himself. But you also bring in all the history, the Shackleton and the other explorers that so fascinate you, and there was a time when the race to the South Pole was this thing where Scott and Amundsen are basically, I don't even know if they understood that they were both, how close they were. Yeah. Because when Scott arrives at the South Pole and finds the Norwegian flag already there in the tent.
Could you imagine?
I mean, how deflating.
I mean, you are in this race. They knew they were racing against each other. Amundsen is the Norwegian explorer. Scott is leading a party. He's British. He's leading an expedition. He has four other men with him. They're racing to the South Pole. Scott's party is suffering, they're frostbitten, they're running out of food. They get to the South Pole, and just as you say, what do they see? They see Amundsen's tent, and they see the Norwegian flag, and Scott basically describes the North Pole then as just the most awful place.
There's a picture of them there with the Norwegian flag in the background of Scott's team. And everybody who follows that knows that Scott did not make it back after that.
Yeah, Scott's trying to race back, and he perishes.
Knowing that they may not get back.
Yeah.
But they don't have enough food.
They don't have enough food. They run out. They run out of food. They freeze. Scott's some of the last words in his diary, which was later found with his frozen body, was, you know, "We shall die like gentlemen."
What is it that drives people to want to do this to themselves to the point where they, and this applies to Henry Worsley too, the main character, to their death?
Yeah, that is the hardest question to answer. And I think there are various components that go into it, because I think even some of the explorers themselves have trouble fully explaining it. But Shackleton talked about the lure of little voices that drew him into Antarctica. I think Worsley always felt that. And in a weird way, I think Worsley's wife captures the essence of what drove Worsley and drives some of these others, that everybody has some Antarctica. That's what Thomas Pynchon, the novelist, said. Everybody has some Antarctica.
Their own personal Antarctica.
Yeah, some place they go to seek answers. In the case of some of these people, it actually happens to be Antarctica. They all have outward goals. Let's get to the South Pole first. Let's be the first to trek solo across Antarctica. But I think to some degree, these are inward quests. They are
because Worsley had two kids and a wife and a family, and you know.
Well, you know, here's to give you an example. On that first expedition where there's the three of them, they want to get to the farthest point that Shackleton had got to. And then from there, they're going to go on to the South Pole. So they get to that farthest point of Shackleton, which was 97 nautical miles from the South Pole. At that point, they were suffering, they were hungry, they were depleted. They look around at this place that had almost lured them to their demise, this grail that had filled their dreams. And what did they see?
Nothing.
Absolutely nothing.
There's nothing just, there. It's just a point on the map.
It's just the point. It's just windswept ice. And they're so cold.
It's whatever degrees parallel.
It's just a geographical data point in a majestic deathscape. I mean, that's really what it is. And Henry Adams, again, getting back to your question, says, what is Antarctica other than a place in which to impose yourself? But I think one of the central questions that Worsley faces, so Worsley always modeled his life on Shackleton, and Shackleton was a great leader. He led by example. He didn't believe in the hierarchies of kind of class and military leadership. He made sure that everybody participated in the same chores. They shared in the same food. Worsley modeled his military command after that. He modeled his life after that kind of leadership. And whenever he was in danger, and on this last expedition when he's alone, he is in more danger than he would ever be in. I mean, everything had gone wrong. He had lost more than 40 pounds, maybe as much as 60. His body is on the verge of collapse, and yet he is so close to the end of his journey, to what he called a rendezvous with history. And he would always ask himself, what would Shackleton do? And he asked himself that in that moment, what would Shackleton do? And the book really explores that question, because it gets at what drives them, but also what is the meaning of leadership?
Yeah. The fact that he's so driven by that what would Shackleton do message, there's another point in the book where they're actually trekking and they run across the hut that Shackleton's crew was in that's basically untouched since 1909.
Yeah.
You know, it's like there, sitting there for 100 and some years. And they sleep overnight in it, the three of them. And it has this mystical effect on all of them that they're in that room that looks the same as it did 100 years earlier.
It's crazy. So they get to Antarctica. You know, Henry Worsley has been dreaming of this expedition since he was a boy. He wasn't able to actually mount an expedition until he was 47. So he's 47 years old. He's with one of the descendants is Will Gow, who's a descendant of Shackleton, a slightly pudgy banker. And then Henry Adams, who was the descendant of the second in command on the Shackleton's Nimrod expedition. He's kind of a scrawny shipping lawyer. The three of them get to Antarctica. They climb up on a hill looking for a place to camp, and they suddenly see in the shallow basin this hut. And there it is. And they know exactly what it was. And they rush inside, as you say. And there it looks as if Shackleton and his party had just momentarily stepped away and might come back. And what is amazing is Adams, you know, he goes over and he finds the bed, the bunk, where his great-grandfather had slept. And, of course, Worsley is scouring excitedly every recess of the room.
He said they gasped.
And Worsley, you know, afterwards, he said, I could not get any closer to my mentor. He looked at Shackleton as his mentor. And there was nothing left to do at that point but to trek to the South Pole.
Well, the story of Henry Worsley is odd. It's sad in a way. It's incredibly inspiring.
Yes.
And in his final voyage, his final expedition, is particularly inspiring. And Will Gow and Henry Adams are still alive, if I understand.
Yes.
And they can look back at this now and know everything and know what he went through. But the book itself is a really beautiful book about obsession and about what drives us. I was going to say demons, but it's not. It's just something that drove these
people. It's a compulsion. We all have longings. We all have dreams that we seek to kind of conquer. And theirs, of course, is very extreme.
Yeah. Well, David Grann, you found another great story for us. We thank you.
Keep
digging and spelunking out there. We'll look for the next one.
Thank you. I want a warmer place next time. Yeah. Miami.
Thank you so much. The book is The White Darkness. The author is David Grann. So nice to have you here, David. I'm Rich Fahle. You are watching PBS Books coverage of the Miami Book Fair 2018. Please stick around. More to come today.